Good afternoon. Welcome to the Church of St. Anne. Today we celebrate the fifth Sunday in ordinary time, and our celebrant for this Mass is Father Chris Schaffner. He's the pastor of the parish of St. Anne. Please rise and greet our celebrant as we sing our first hymn, O Lord, I Know You Are Near. O Lord, I know You are near, standing always at my side. You guard me from the foe, and You lead me in ways everlasting. Lord, You have searched my soul, and You know when I sit and when I stand. Your hand is upon me, protecting me from death, keeping me from harm. Oh Lord, I know You are near, sending always at my side. You guard me from the foe, and You lead me in ways everlasting.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My friends, as we prepare ourselves to enter into the sacred mysteries of Jesus Christ, let us begin by calling to mind our sins, asking God for His pardon and mercy. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise You, we bless You, we adore You, we glorify You. We give You thanks for Your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, You take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For You alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Keep your family safe, O Lord, with unfailing care, that relying solely on the hope of heavenly grace, they may be defended always by Your protection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, Your Son, who lives and reigns with You in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Job. Job spoke, saying, is not man's life on earth a drudgery? Are not his days those of hirelings? He is a slave who longs for the shade, a hireling who waits for his wages. So I have been assigned months of misery, and troubled nights have been allotted to me. If in bed I say, when shall I arise? Then the night drags on. I am filled with restlessness until the dawn. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle. They come to an end without hope. Remember that my life is like the wind. I shall not see happiness again. The word of the Lord. Praise the Lord who heals the brokenhearted.
Praise the Lord who heals the brokenhearted.
Praise the Lord, for he is good. Sing praise to our God, for he is gracious. It is fitting to praise him. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. The dispersed of Israel he gathers.
Praise the Lord who heals the brokenhearted.
He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He tells the number of the stars. He calls each by name.
Praise the Lord who heals the brokenhearted.
Great is our Lord and mighty in power. To his wisdom there is no limit. The Lord sustains the lowly. The wicked he casts to the ground.
Praise the Lord who heals the brokenhearted.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, if I preach the gospel, this is no reason for me to boast, for an obligation has been imposed on me, and woe to me if I do not preach it. If I do so willingly, I have a recompense, but if unwillingly, then I have been entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my recompense? That, when I preach, I offer the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. Although I am free in regard to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so as to win over as many as possible. To the weak, I became weak, to win over the weak. I have become all things to all, to save at least some. All this I do for the sake of the gospel, so that I too may have a share in it. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia. Christ took away our infirmities and bore our diseases. Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
On leaving the synagogue, Jesus entered the house of Simon and Andrew. With James and John. Simon's mother-in-law lay sick with a fever. They immediately told him about her. He approached, grasped her hand, and helped her up. Then the fever left her, and she waited on them. When it was evening, after sunset, they brought to him all who were ill or possessed by demons. The whole town was gathered at the door. He cured many who were sick with various diseases, and he drove out many demons, not permitting them to speak because they knew him. Rising very early before dawn, he left and went off to a deserted place where he prayed. Simon and those who were with him pursued him, and on finding him said, "Everyone is looking for you." He told them, "Let us go on to the nearby villages, that I may preach there also. For this purpose have I come." So he went into their synagogues, preaching and driving out demons throughout the whole of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord. I don't know how many of you have ever been to San Francisco. It's a nice place to visit. Personally, I don't know that I would want to live there. I was able to visit there briefly back in college when I went to present some research at a conference there. And I had worked for a couple summers with my chemistry professor doing research in a field known as physical chemistry. And, you know, the project we worked on and my working title for my presentation was Energy Transfer from Self-Trapped Excitons in Sodium Chloride to Fissorbed Carbon Dioxide. Stimulating. But it really has some real applications to the coating on microchips, and that's the purpose for research of that sort. Now, as exciting as that conference was, the highlight of the trip was being able to go out in our free time and do a bit of sightseeing. So my friend and I, we walked around San Francisco. We saw Lombard Street. Some of you may be familiar with that, the crookedest street in America. Went out to Pier 39, where hundreds of sea lions gather daily. We weren't able quite to get to the Golden Gate Bridge to walk it, but from a distance, we could see it. And as you may know, this is one of the wonderful marvels of human engineering, the seventh longest bridge in the world. And each year, over 10 million people visit to admire this bridge, and they walk across it, they look at the waters down below. But for all of its beauty and its fascination, there's a very dark side to the Golden Gate Bridge. It has held the dubious distinction of being the place where more people have chosen to end their lives than anywhere else in the world, surpassed only in recent years by a similar bridge in China. Statistically speaking, on average, one person jumps from this bridge every 2 weeks. And back in 2004, a film crew was doing a documentary about the bridge and those who visited it. And so for an entire year, they placed a camera on the bridge, filming people going back and forth across it. But as they were going back over their footage the next year, they realized that they had caught on film the desperate last moments of 24 individuals who had decided they could not go on any longer. And suddenly they realized that the purpose of their film had to change. Instead of documenting tourists and this marvel of engineering, they began to ask questions about what's going on in the hearts and the minds of people in this desperate situation, and how do we help to care for them? And as you look at some of this footage, there are moments certainly that made you want to cheer as someone's preparing to jump and someone steps in to rescue them. But there are also other moments that made you want to cry as small groups gathered around simply watching as they jumped. Or perhaps even worse, entire groups of people just passing by, ignoring these individuals in their pain. Now, we may ask, you know, what does the church teach on individuals who kill themselves? And the church is very clear that we do not judge the state of the soul of any individual at that critical moment. And we never deny and we never downplay the power of God's mercy and his love, because we don't know what's going on in their hearts and their minds. Only God knows that, and he reaches out with his infinite love and mercy. He has the power to redeem those individuals. So we can never despair of the soul of one who has committed suicide. But I think we still wonder on a very human level. We wonder what might drive a person to perform that ultimate act of desperation from which there's no going back. We wonder, how can we help others in similar situations? I know I've asked the same questions myself. I probably had a half dozen people that I've known who have killed themselves. And certainly, in some cases, mental illness plays a role. But overwhelmingly, as you may expect, most had simply lost hope.
They felt alone, no longer able to see the good in life. Their only desire was to end the pain, a tragic, permanent solution to the temporary problems of life. And I think the scriptures that we hear today, you know, in some ways they're very heavy, particularly the words of the prophet Job that we hear in the first reading today. And I can't help but listen to his words today and see a man who has gone through so much in his life, once very blessed, and then, as we know his story, everything's taken away from him. And he's been thrust into the throes of what I would describe as depression. To him, life has become a burden. He says, for months I've gone through this. He experiences all these afflictions in his body, in his mind, in his spirit. And the energy that he needs to just get through one day is overwhelming. And so he describes how this pain keeps going on month after month. He feels this misery. And at night, particularly, he describes how his mind just keeps racing. He can't stop thinking about his problems. And so he loses sleep. The more he worries about not being able to sleep, the worse his restlessness gets. And so it affects him very emotionally, physically, spiritually. In fact, the last words of the passage today say it all. He says, my life is like the wind. I shall not see happiness again. You know, those are some pretty heavy words, words that reflect an utter hopelessness. You know, I wonder how many times we've seen loved ones in the same situation. You know, those who are crying out. You know, their pain in their life is too much for them. Family members, friends, coworkers, others in our life. You know, I think it's kind of a plague among our people today that a lot of people, they suffer largely unnoticed. The world around them just goes on about its business. And so many are feeling so utterly alone. And you look at the statistics, they're quite eye-opening. In any given year, one out of every 10 individuals will battle depression. One out of every 25 preschoolers are clinically depressed. 15% of depressed individuals eventually commit suicide. And at one point they said that by the year 2020, which of course we've already passed, depression now has become the second largest contributor to death after heart disease. Now we look at numbers like that and we realize the fact that every single one of us here today is going to be affected by depression at some point in our lives, whether it's our own experience or that of someone that we love. And part of our Christian duty is to love them, to be able to recognize when they're suffering and to show them the compassion and the love of Jesus Christ, which is what they so desperately need. You know, so often we look at, you know, what causes depression, and many will look at only the organic causes, you know, something in the structure, the chemistry of the brain that can often be controlled with medication, much the same as we use medication to control our physical, you know, problems, cholesterol, blood pressure. Circumstances certainly also cause a person to become depressed. Maybe it's abuse of some kind, emotional, physical, sexual. Relationships that have gone bad, neglect, criticism, addictions, violence, poverty, the loss of a loved one, loneliness, you know, all the bad things that happen in life. There's no denying there are challenges that weigh down our spirits. But we often don't talk of the spiritual causes of depression. Our contemporary mindset wants to reject the idea that the devil is at least partly to blame for depression and many of the other problems in life. But if we dismiss the possibility that the enemy at least takes advantage of our circumstances and our weakness in order to make it worse, then we've already lessened our spiritual defenses, made it that much easier for him to gain victory over us. Now we're battling a real enemy who delights in our spiritual weakness, our emotional lows. One who will tempt us to do things during these times that maybe we would not otherwise do. And Jesus knew this. You know, that's why we see him so often as we do today, not just curing an illness, but at the same time driving out the evil spirits, targeting the suffering itself along with the spiritual source of that suffering. And I think what this teaches us is that to battle the demons, particularly of depression, we have to attack it from so many different sides. You know, God gave us the gift of medication for a reason. You know, I always tell people, take advantage of that. You go out, take advantage of the social support that we receive from counselors, therapists, supportive family and friends. But don't forget the power of prayer as well. You know, the power of God, inviting that into our heart and into our soul to help us to be healed. Ultimately, it's this integral approach that's going to bring success. Because we're fighting against this common enemy. It takes the efforts of those who love the individual, along with the very power of God himself, to work for our good. And yet, it can be very difficult. And I think still, after all of this, we may still ask ourselves, you know, I have this friend, you know, they're going through this. I've done all I can for them. What more can I do? And I think, first of all, one of the things we have to realize is that we don't have that power. We are not the Savior. God is the one who heals. But we are called forth to encourage, to love, to give comfort. And I think this is what St. Paul teaches us so well today. So he reached out to the suffering in a very special way, which he encourages us to do as well, with a very special kind of empathy, where our heart connects with the heart of another, even to the point of entering into their sorrows. He says, to the weak, I became weak. I become all things to all for the sake of the gospel. Basically, what he's saying is that he responded according to the need of the individual. He didn't become a different person, but rather emphasized what that person most needed in that moment. And so, to those who feel themselves arrogant and self-righteous, his words were firm. They were forceful. But to those who are weak, those who had no strength to fall back on, maybe we might say those who are sorrowful, he spoke with a gentle compassion, a tenderness. You know, for ourselves, when a loved one is depressed, you know, they don't need someone telling them they should be ashamed for feeling that way. They don't need someone yelling at them to just get over it. They need to know the love of Christ, and they know that through our compassion and through our care. They need encouragement and support, someone to accompany them, a gentle guiding hand to help them seek the help they need. And yeah, I think that can be very painful, even for us, to watch a loved one go through that. But we need to have that confidence that God's love and mercy are very healing. And that's where wholeness comes from. And so we do our part. We reach out, we lift them up, we support them, we entrust them to God in prayer, and we muster the courage and the strength to mediate the love of God through these very sincere acts of compassion. You know, Simon did that wonderfully. We heard in the gospel, when his mother-in-law was sick with a fever, he came, he comforted her, he tended to her needs, he didn't ignore her suffering, but he helped her to do those things that she couldn't do for herself. And then at the very first opportunity, when Jesus comes to the door, we're told he immediately brings Jesus to her, the great physician. And he touches her, and he blesses her, and he heals her, and he casts out the demons that held her captive. And I think this tells us what is most important, that our job as Christians is to bring Jesus to those who suffer from a lack of hope. You know, let your faith in Jesus sustain them until their hearts are ready to receive his healing power. And I'm under no false impression that is, that perhaps as I speak today, there may even be a handful of us here today who are going through this very thing. Some of us here today might be dealing with a depression, and I encourage you certainly to accept the love and the care of those around you, to be persistent, to not give up, offering prayers for your healing and confidence. Open your heart to our Lord, who opens up a path for us through the darkness. And remember the story of Job. You know, the one who seems so lost today. He's the same one who would also later proclaim these beautiful words of hope, even in the midst of his suffering. He would say, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, he will stand upon the earth, and in my flesh, I will see God. I will see him with my own eyes. That's the hope we need to hold on to. And it's a beautiful reminder that even in the very worst of our circumstances, hope always remains when we're able to keep our eyes on the Lord.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My friends, as we come before our Father in heaven, let us do so in confident faith that he hears and answers all of our prayers.
For Pope Francis, our bishops, all priests and deacons, for all who hold and teach the Catholic faith, may they be faithful in preaching the gospel message so as to bring more souls to Christ. We pray to the Lord. For those struggling in their faith, may God grant them a guiding presence to point them to a fuller, more joyful expression of their faith in Jesus Christ. We pray to the Lord. For those battling depression, sorrow, disappointment, or grief, may they be strengthened through the presence of our Lord and the encouragement and prayer of loved ones. We pray to the Lord. For doctors, nurses, and all who work in the healthcare industry, may they be granted the knowledge and skill they need to care effectively for the sick and injured, and the compassion to do so with the heart of Christ. We pray to the Lord. For our parish and school community of St. Anne's, and for our communities of Le Sueur and Henderson, may we find ways to continue to support one another through these troubled times. We pray to the Lord. For the fulfillment of the needs of all our families and friends, especially for Bonnie Spicala, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord. For the souls of all the faithful departed, may they know the mercy of Christ and rise with him to new and eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
And Father in heaven, we turn to you in humble, confident faith that you hear and accept all of our needs. As we present to you all of our needs this day, answer them all in accord with your most holy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
As the deer longs for flowing streams, so longs my soul for you, O God. My soul does thirst for the living God. When shall I come to see your face? Tears have fed me day and night, while some have said, where is your God? But I recall, as my soul pours dry, the days of praise within your heart. Why do I mourn and toil within, when it is mine to hope in God? I shall again sing praise to Him. He is my help. He is my God.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O Lord, our God, who once established these created things to sustain us in our frailty, grant, we pray, that they may become for us now the sacrament of eternal life. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Anne and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, his assistant Andrew, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. And now, at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Of the Lord is given to you. Receive it in your hearts. The joy of the Lord is with you too. Receive it in your hearts. Make it glow. those in need. He is in your heart.
Let us pray. O God, who have willed that we be partakers in the one bread and the one chalice, grant us, we pray, so to live that, made one in Christ, we may joyfully bear fruit for the salvation of the world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. This is the time of year where there's a lot going on, a lot of preparations being made, particularly for the beginning of our Lenten season, which is coming up in just about a week and a half. But first, let me just speak a little bit about a few items of interest that you will find at the entrances of the church today. As you know, this last December, we started the year of St. Joseph in the Universal Church. And you'll find a couple items related to that on how we're celebrating the year of St. Joseph here in our parish. You'll find these very beautiful prayer cards with an image of our very own St. Joseph statue, which is right behind me. On the back of the card is a prayer known as the Hail Joseph, which is a prayer attributed to St. Louis de Montfort from the 17th century. On February 15th, our parish will be participating in a 33-day consecration to St. Joseph. So each day we'll have a brief reflection that will be shared about St. Joseph, how his virtue leads us to Jesus. You can watch those reflections on our parish Facebook page and plan to join us in prayer, again, beginning Monday, February 15th. You'll also find at the door, in relation to St. Joseph, a litany of St. Joseph. This is a litany that is to be prayed each day of that consecration as part of the preparation for consecration at the end of those 33 days. As I mentioned, Lent begins on Wednesday, February 17th, a week and a half from today. I don't have a copy of it here with me, but you'll find at the doors a copy of the Lenten Magnificat devotional booklet. That booklet is full of a lot of daily meditations for each day of Lent to help you enter more fully into a prayerful mindset, a prayerful heart set during the season of Lent. This past week, our students at St. Anne's School celebrated Catholic Schools Week. As part of their celebrations, they honored workers at our local thrift store at Treasures in Town, our police and fire departments, and those working in healthcare. The students in preschool through grades three also made some bird feeders, some pine cone bird feeders that were then delivered to our elderly in the facilities around town. to share some of their work than with our wider parish. There is a basket of extra bird feeders in the back today. You're most welcome to take one with you when you go hang it up and feed the birds. And then also, this is also the time of year, right before Lent starts, that our diocese begins the Catholic Services Appeal. You'll find in the bulletin today a flyer that describes all of the benefits of our donations that we give to this cause this year. There are, I believe, 20 different ministries throughout the Archdiocese, none of which can support themselves solely on, or no parish can solely support. So I invite you to take a look at that, pray over that, and then those who have given to the appeal in the past probably or have already received an invitation to give again this year. If you have not, on the tables in the back, there is an envelope that's with a card that you can fill out, pull off, place into the envelope, and you can mail that into the Catholic Services Appeal Foundation. Every little bit helps to be Christ to those most in need in our world. And then finally today, during Lent, I'd like to make a very special invitation to you to take part in a series known as The Search. This is a small group discussion format series that will help us to reflect on the big questions of life. These are foundational questions such as, what am I seeking? Who am I? Who is Jesus Christ? Why the church? Am I saved? We'll be forming small groups for discussion that, at least for now, will meet online during Lent. If you would like to join a group, please indicate your interest by signing up at the website, which is indicated in the bulletin this weekend. And please do that by Ash Wednesday, because we hope to begin at least one group that next Sunday is what I'm thinking, at least for the group that I will lead. Depending on the number of those interested, we do hope to form perhaps several groups at different times throughout the week. Certainly, if you have any questions then, please contact me or the parish office. As we conclude then today, let us offer our prayer to the Blessed Virgin as we ask her intercession for us and our needs. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Oh, bless the Lord, my soul, His grace to thee proclaim, and all that is within me join to bless His holy name. Oh, bless the Lord, my soul, His mercy bear in mind, forget not all His benefits, the Lord. Bless His holy name, whose grace hath made us whole, whose loving kindness crowns our days. Oh, bless the Lord.